برائے خوشنودی حضرت ابو طالب علیہ السلام بلند تر سلامات.
اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم. بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. والصلاة والسلام على اشرف الانبیاء والمرسلین حبیب قلوبنا وشفیع ذنوبنا وطبیب نفوسنا ابی القاسم المصطفی محمد وعلى اهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين لا سيما بقية الله في الارضين وحجتي على الخلائق اجمعين مهدي هذه الامه وطاووس اهل الجنه الحجة ابن الحسن الأسكري روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. As we are gathered here tonight, and as we have been attending the majalis of Sayyid al-Shuhada over the past 3 weeks, and we will continue to do so, what is important for you and I to realize is that why do we come to these majalis? We have been recommended about being in the state of sadness, about lamenting, about wearing black, about being in the state of azar. But what is the significance? Why? What's the point? Every year we do this. And there are so many traditions from the Ahlul Bayt about the importance of the crying, the importance of being in the state of azar, that you find that you cannot find it amongst other traditions or perhaps other imams as well. What I would like to touch upon tonight is the significance of these majalis and some of the potential reasons why so much emphasis has been put on such gatherings. We find that in one tradition, the Holy Messenger of God mentions, "Inna liqatl al-Husayn hararatan fi qulub al-mu'minin lan tabridu abada." Surely, in the hearts of the believers, when it comes to the martyrdom of Sayyid al-Shuhada, a heat, a fire is ignited such that this heat and fire and warmth shall never be extinguished. And you find this in reality that after nearly 1400 years, Arba'in is coming in 2 weeks' time. You find that as though Sayyid al-Shuhada was martyred in this 21st century. You have 20 million people walking and marching towards the blessed shrine of Sayyid al-Shuhada. We find that this heat and this warmth and this love, not has it not only reduced and diminished, rather day by day and year by year, this is increasing. Why? Why? I would like to share with you a few traditions about the encouragement that we have about attending such majalis. Because many of us, or some of us, we come to the majalis but maybe out of a habit. It is the first of Muharram, it is Arba'in, it is the third of Muharram, how can I not go anywhere? Let's go to a majlis. Sometimes we overlook the importance and significance of these majalis. I would like to recite a few traditions for you to understand the significance and then look at some of the dimensions that why there is such an emphasis on this. So one tradition, Rasulullah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, mentions to Sayyidah Fatima, and she says, "Kullu aynin baqiyatun yawm al-qiyamah illa aynun bakat ala musab al-Husayn fa innaha dhahikatun mustabshirah bina'im al-Jannah." Beautiful tradition. The Holy Prophet tells his beloved daughter that, "Know my daughter, that all the eyes will be crying on the day of judgment, accept that I, which has shed tear for the musiba, for the tragedy of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, for that I will be in the state of happiness and surur because of the blessings and the bountings of Jannah. There are other traditions as well that says there are all the eyes are crying apart from three eyes. One eye is the eye that has been kept away from haram for the sake of Allah. That's the first one. Second one is the eye which has stayed awake in the middle of the night to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to worship Him, to be in the state of munajat, number two. And the third one, it is the eye which has shed tear. Some traditions say even to the amount of a wing of a mosquito. Wing of a mosquito. This is the third type of eye. Further on, now this tradition takes it to another level about the importance. The sixth Imam says, فَعَلَى مِثْلَ الْحُسَيْنِ فَلْيَبْكِ الْبَاكُونَ فَإِنَّ الْبُكَاءَ عَلَيْهِ يَحِتُّ الذُّنُوبَ الْإِظَامِ. Subhanallah. Surely for someone like Sayyid al-Shuhada, people shall cry and shed tears. Why? For surely crying for Abu Abdullah al-Hussein diminishes, reduces, takes away, wipes away great sins that you and I have committed. Just shedding tears, coming to these majalis. Subhanallah. And you know, when the Imam is speaking, when the Ma'asum is speaking, the Ma'asum is not like you and I, we just want to exaggerate. We say, okay, you know, for example, 10 hours I've been waiting for you, as an example. No, 10 hours I've been waiting maybe half an hour for someone, I say 10 hours, it means a lot. No, the Imam and the Ma'asum, when they say something, it is not out of their emotion, it's not because they got excited, it's not because they wanted to please someone, because they got hyped up, you know, the audience, they were saying something, so this speaker went on and on and on and said things which maybe there's no reality to. No, when the Ma'asum says something, it is directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they do not utter a word except where the pleasure and the satisfaction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. Therefore, the ahadith of the Ma'asumin, after they have been verified and authenticated, not any hadith that we take, a hadith which the scholars have authenticated, then this hadith, it is the Ma'asum from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has mentioned it. So we find these traditions, they are highlighting the significance of the azah, of the martyrdom, of the majalis, and the tear for Abu Abdullah. And one more tradition, the sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi, mentions, ma min ahadin qala fil Husayn sha'ran. There is not a single individual who recites a line of poetry for the sake of Abu Abdullah, fabaka, and he cries, wa abka bihi, and he makes others cry, illa awjaba Allah lahu al-jannah wa ghafara lahu, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall forgive all of his sins and he will make paradise an obligation for him. The other tradition says abka, aw baka, aw tabaka. Three. Baka is what? Is when the person cries. Abka is when you make someone else cry. And tabaka, sometimes, you know, the person is reciting, for some reason, you cannot shed tears. Whatever that reason is. Tabaka is when you make yourself look like you're shedding tears. That's why you go, many of the ulama, you find, for example, in the pictures, they hold their hand like this. Maybe they're not crying, but you put yourself in the state as though you're crying. So we find that the Imam, even for such an individual, he's placing such a reward. And we have our great scholars, someone like Imam Khomeini, rahmatullahi alayhi, he comes forward and he says that it is because of Muharram and Safar that Islam has been kept alive. If there was no Muharram, there was no Safar, there was no these gatherings, we would not have Islam today. That's why Ayatollah Mujtahidi Tehrani, another great scholar who passed away a few years ago, I was listening to him yesterday, he was saying that many of our scholars have this ada, they have this tradition that before they want to stand in prayers, before they stand in prayers, and he was saying that he himself does it the same way. He says that before they stand and they do the iqama, and they say takbiratul ihram, they send salams to Sayyidul Shuhada. They say, Sallallahu alayka ya Abu Abdullah. He said that once I asked this scholar, why is it that every time before you start your prayers, not in your prayers, not in your prayers, before you start your prayers, you are the one who are sending salams upon Abu Abdullah. He says, do we not recite that Ashhadu annaka qad aqamta as-salat wa ataita az-zakat? You are the one, in all of the ziyarat of the Imam, we say this, qad aqamta as-salat. Oh Sayyid al-Shuhada, you are the individual who upheld prayers, you established prayers. You were the individual who built the foundations, i.e. protected the institution of salah. In the real meaning, not the prayer of going up and down, up down, because Yazid the same day, he also prayed as well. The Ibn Muljam also prayed as well. Many of these people used to pray. But when we say about establishing of prayer, it's different with reciting prayers. You say, have you done your prayers? We don't say reciting your prayers. Reciting prayers, Ibn Muljam recited prayers. The people who came on the Dhuhr of Ashura and killed Sayyidul Shahada, they also prayed on the same noon. The traditions say, the Maqatil say, when they wanted to go and kill Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, they would say, they would do takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ya Allah. They would call people, do you want to achieve salvation? Come and behead the grandson of the Holy Prophet. They also used to call towards Allah. They also used to recite prayers. They also used to read Quran. But when we say Abu Abdullah established prayer, it is not the physical prayer. It is a prayer with full reality and essence and core of prayer. That is why you never have the recitation of salat in the Quran. You say, aqim as-salat. Aqim means what? Iqama is what? When you have a pillar and you want to stand this pillar, you want to establish this pillar, you say, iqama. Iqama. When you're standing, you want to stand in prayers. قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ means what? Stand up. Meaning what? Meaning when you say establishing prayers, it's the whole institution of prayer. It's not just up, down, up, down, up, down. And the institution of prayer is tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. It is the prayer which enables me to hold back from doing evil. It is a prayer which encourages me to do good. Not that I recite prayer and I go and kill others. I recite prayer and I have bad akhlaq towards my family. I recite prayers and I have ill, foul language towards others. What sort of prayer is this? Inna salat tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. The Quran says clearly, if it is true salah, it is meant to prevent me from committing ill, bad, evil actions. As-salat mi'rajul mu'min. It is the ascension of the mu'min. You and I, when we pray, we ascend. Or some of us, whenever we pray, we remember wherever, whatever we've left, whatever we've lost anywhere, we pray. After prayer, we remember where that thing was. We think, we catch up with the things that we didn't have time to think about before. This is not salah. Mi'rajul mu'min. This is the ascension. I had a teacher, he was one of the students of Ayatollah Jawadi Amuli. He would say that a true salah is one that between your first rak'at of salat and the second rak'at, there is a difference in your spirituality, in your state. The first surah al-Fatiha needs to be different to the second surah al-Fatiha. Why? The whole rak'at I've prayed and I'm the same, so what's the point? What did I do? Just exercise? Salah, my brothers and sisters, is not exercise. Salah is a spiritual ascension. And you know whether your salah is accepted or not. How? See, after salah, if you are the same as what you were before, then know this salah is you've just ticked the box. You've just ticked the box, you've done your taklif, but not necessarily is accepted. As salah is accepted and is elevated to Allah, that makes me a different person. That after this salah in my middle of my business day, they say, why five times? Why in the morning, noon, maghrib, for example? One of the reasons is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make sure that there is a checkpoint throughout the day and night. That in the middle of my work, in the middle of my business, in the middle of my studies, Dhuhr time comes, I go and stand in prayers. Meaning that, remember that even in the midst of your business, your studies, your work, whatever you're doing, go and remember Allah. So after you go back to your business, you don't do haram, you don't take people's rights, you don't oppress anyone, you don't sell something too high priced, for example. This is reminding you. Not that I go and pray and come back and lie to my customer. What salah was that? In the morning when I wake up after the night of being asleep, the first thing I do is to recite my prayers, to establish my prayers. Why? Again, to remember, to remind myself that what is my purpose, what is the reason for my existence and where I'm going to. Anyway, so we find that before the salah, this great scholar Ayatollah Mujtahidi Tehrani would say that, we say, sallallahu alayka ya Abu Abdullah. You remember the sacrifices of Sayyid al-Shuhada and appreciate and you show your gratitude towards the Imam. So, this was the first area, that the importance of these majalis is what has kept Islam alive. Why? The first area is that these majalis enables for the human intellect, rationality, and number two, the human emotions to come together. You find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially in the school of Ahlul Bayt, what is specific to this school is the combination of rationality and the intellect. If you just take your rationality, and your emotion. If you just take your emotion, you do things emotionally only. Islam doesn't endorse this. Because through your emotions, you can end up doing things which are outside the scope of the Sharia and the intellect. No. Don't completely let your emotions free. One side. The other side, there are those who just say, Aql, Aql, Aql. Oh, Baba, am I a robot? I'm a human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me this heart. Sometimes I'm happy, sometimes I'm sad. I need to use it. I need to utilize it in one way or another. Not completely suppress it. The person dies, no, why do you cry? Bid'ah. The person cries, you go on the grave, you try, it's fatah. No, this is bid'ah. What do I do then? Am I a robot? No. We find that only following the intellect and forgetting about the emotions of the human being puts the human being very binary and rigid and dry. Very dry. Everything's black and white. And this type of human being is not able to be steadfast in his religion either. Because again, coming back to these majalis, what drives these majalis behind that intellectual discourses which takes place on the minbar is that emotional connection which you establish with the Imam of your time. That sometimes maybe you listen to 10,000 lectures, it doesn't hit you, it doesn't penetrate you, it doesn't make you act until you remember, for example, the masiba of Ali ibn al-Asghar on the hands, on the arms of Sayyid al-Shuhada. That pierces through. That breaks the heart. And when the heart is broken, you say, oh Imam, how can I help you? How can I be with you? And you say, you want to be with me? Then you need to do X, Y, and Z. You need to follow the Quran. You need to follow the Sunnah. You need to follow the traditions. The arqam in place. Yes? So you find that the emotion is there to establish the relationship, to push the person forward, to follow what the aql and the sharia say. And the combination of these two makes the human being perfect and allows him to traverse the path towards perfection. That is one area. The second area we find that the significance and the reason why so much importance has been placed on these majalis is that when we come to these majalis, we remember the Ahlul Bayt. By remembering them, we're not just remembering a historical event which took place and we cry and finish until next year. No, that is not the case. If anyone's here to just remember, only remember an historical event, and that's it, recite history. No, this is not the purpose of these majalis. What we find that in the traditions we have, that Sayyid al-Shuhada as well as the other A'imma have two types of personality, two types of dimension, if you like. One is a dimension which is haqiqi, one which is huquqi. Haqiqi, huquqi. What does it mean? It means that you and I, these 2 months, and the rest of the year, we attend these majalis. One, we remember the personality of the Imam, which is شخصيت حقيقي, Sayyid al-Shuhada, Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen, the son of Fatima al-Zahra, died, martyred on such and such date on the plains of Karbala, buried in Karbala. This was such an individual, he passed away. That's one dimension. However, what makes Sayyid al-Shuhada alive today is not the personality of Abu Abdullah. This is very important. Ayatollah Jawadi mentions this. It is not the personality. It's not Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salam only. No. It is what Hussein and Sayyid al-Shuhada stood for, which is شخصيات حقوقي. حقوقي. When Sayyid al-Shuhada, someone like Yazid la'anatullahi alayhi, comes forward and he says that pledge allegiance to me, what does Abu Abdullah say? Listen carefully to this. What does he say? He doesn't say, I do not pledge allegiance to you. No. Because it's not شخصيات حقيقي. It's not a personal thing. He says, مثلي لا يبايع مثله. Means what? Someone like me. Not me. Not Hussein. It's not about Hussein. It's about the principles of Hussein. Someone like me does not pledge allegiance to. Again, it's not about Yazid. Yazid's dead, finished, done, dusted. But the idea, the mentality of Yazid still exists. Someone like me does not pledge allegiance to someone like Yazid. Someone who wants to be Husseini never goes in the Yazidi's camp. And that is why that tradition, whether it's authentic or not, there is discussion that kullu yawmin ashura wa kullu ardin karbala, that every day is ashura, every land is karbala. Some scholars debate the authenticity of it, but the point is that every day is karbala means what? Every day is ashura, every land is karbala. No, here is London, it's not karbala. And today is not ashura. So what does it mean? It means that the principles of Ashura today, in the 21st century, living in the West, still exists. How? Know that every day of your life, we get invited to different places. We have different temptations. Know that there is always a Nurani, there is always a Husseini call, and there is always a Yazidi call. You know that this wedding that you're going to go to, there is going to be a Majlis of Haram. That Majlis of Haram is a Majlis with Yazid would be placed with. And me rejecting that invitation and staying at home is an invitation which Sayyid al-Shuhada would be pleased with. So, مثلي لا يبايع مثله. One example is this. One example is that I have become angry at home now. I want to shout, I want to break, I want to insult my family members. It happens all the time. I want to break my relationships with my family members. It happens. If I want to be a Husseini, what happens? What happens? You know, on the night of Ashura, Shimr, la'anatullah alayhi, comes forward and he calls upon whom? Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas. He calls upon the sons of his sister because they were cousins. Did you know that? They were cousins. He said, come, I will give you immunity. I will leave you alone. Imagine, they tell Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, I leave you alone. You just go. You're safe. Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas does not even respond. This. You know what Sayyid al-Shuhada says? This is written in all the maqatil. He says, "Ajibuhu wa in kana fasiqan." Look at the akhlaq of Sayyid al-Shuhada. Look at the call of Hussein. He says, "Oh Abbas." This is, I am saying this bit, that he is your cousin. He has a blood relationship with you. Answer him, even if he's a corrupt person, still answer him. Know that you and I, when we break our relationships, and this is Shimr. We have relatives like Shimr? No. We break relationships. Why? Oh, this person didn't invite me to his majlis. Didn't invite me for his wedding. Why didn't I? He said salam to me first. He then said salam to that one. These are the issues we have. I called him twice on Eid. He didn't call me. Why should I call him all the time? Well, leave this cousin. If he doesn't want to go and come with me, leave him. These are the excuses we give. But Sayyid al-Shuhada, on the night of Ashura, he goes, says, answer your cousin. Answer this mal'oon. He's blood related to you. So you find that the Husseini call is always there. The Yazidi, this is on the personal matters. This is on the social matters. Now take that until when it comes to the ideology. The ideology, you find them in different forms. Al-Qaeda, Daesh, ISIS, different centuries, they appear in different forms. It's the same mentality. It's the same mentality continues. And you have, again, the followers of the Ahlul Bayt that until today, if they want to go to Ziyarah, there is that fear. Until today, different parts of the world, because they are the lovers of Sayyid al-Shuhada, they need to be subject to terrorism in different forms. So what can we do to help those individuals? What can we do to support those orphans who are left behind? What can we do to help, you know, all of the imams, one after another, Imam Zainul Abidin, as these days we are remembering him, Imam Sajjad, salawatullah, salamuhu alayhi. They say when he passed away, when they were doing the ghusl and the kafan, they came and they found marks on his shoulder, like his grandfather, Amir al-Mu'mineen. When they inquired, they said these were the marks when he would carry provision, food, different things for the orphans, for the needy. Amir al-Mu'mineen was the same. All of the imams were the same. And no one would even know. Amir al-Mu'mineen would do it in the streets of Kufa in the middle of the night. No one would even knew. And during the day, they would say, "You are the Khalifa of the Muslims. How come you're not doing anything for our children?" The Imam would take the insults. He would take it. And then when he passed away, they realized it was Ali. In the middle of the night, he would go and leave bread for those orphans of Kufa. This is the sincerity of Ali. This is the servitude of Ali. This is the helping of Ali. This is the Husseini call that we also need to respond to. When Abu Abdullah said, "Hal min nasirin yansuruna?" Is there any helper to help us? The traditions say that this was not limited to that time. No, he knew that these individuals, they're not going to help him. He said that call for you and I as well. That voice of the call of Abu Abdullah continues until the Day of Judgment. Because the mission, the principles of Abu Abdullah, they are eternal. From different dimensions, whether it's about the universal principles that he stood for, the mercy, the compassion, the love, the forgiveness, everything that he manifested. You have all heard the stories. Whether it is that, whether when he says, all the followers of Abu Sufyan, "In lam yakun lakum deen, wa in kuntum la takhafun al ma'ad, fakunu ahraran fi dunyakum." That if you have no religion, and if you have no fear of Allah and the Day of Judgment, then be free in your world. Because someone who is free, when a 6-month-old infant is raised and he says, "If you have no mercy upon me, have mercy upon this 6-month-old infant," if you're a human being, not someone with religion, you're a human being, we would respond to this call. Therefore, this eternal personality of Sayyid al-Shuhada is what keeps him alive until the Day of Judgment. When Abu Abdullah does what he did for the sake of Allah, is the other dimension. Sincerity and ikhlas. He says, "Ma indakum yanfad, wa ma indallahi baq." Quran says that what is with you, it will perish. But what is with Allah will stay. What does it mean? It means that if you and I have ikhlas in what we do, Ikhlas. Having ikhlas means that what you do is only for the sake of Allah. When you do whatever you do it only and only for the sake of Allah. It means that you're connecting your action, you're connecting yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is eternal, then you and your action also becomes eternal. Abu Abdullah today, he is alive. Why? He's eternal. Why? Because what he did was for the sake of Allah. If it was for his own sake, he would have perished as well. Because Allah is eternal, Sayyid al-Shuhada did everything for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him eternal. The same way, you and I, whatever we do, we help at home, we look after our children, you are nice towards your husband, towards your wife, you serve your neighbors, you give charity, you forgive others, you restrain your anger. Do it for the sake of Allah. Don't do it for your wife. Don't do it for your husband. Because when you do it for your wife or your husband or your neighbor or your cousin, you say, okay, I did this, how come they didn't do it back? You know, many people come to us, they say, okay, why should I always forgive them? My wife, my husband has done X, Y, and Z. Every time I am the one who forgives them, why doesn't she come forward? I am the one who always does X, Y, and Z. Why doesn't he do it? I am the one who always give gifts towards my mother, for example, my cousin. Why don't they do it? I am the one who goes and helps my neighbors. Why don't they do it? Well, this shows that it's not because of Allah you're doing it. You're doing it for them. You don't get a response, you get upset. You say, okay, next time I'm not going to do it. But when you do it for the sake of Allah, you say, إِنَّمَا نُطْئِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. A whole verse is revealed in the honor of this Panjtan unto the day of judgment, whoever recites the Quran, when it comes to that verse, they will remember. Why? They gave the iftar, the few breads they have, for the sake of Allah, to the orphan, to the yatim, to the asir. A verse is revealed. Amir al-Mu'mineen gives his ring. Maybe not, doesn't worth much. The value wasn't much. There were others after him who donated much more than Amir al-Mu'mineen. But a whole verse is revealed in the honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Why? Not because of the ring. Because of the sincerity and ikhlas of Amir al-Mu'mineen. That he does it only and only for the sake of Allah. Sayyid al-Shuhada did it for the sake of Allah. He remained eternal. You know, every dimension we pull, every part of Ashura and the movement of Abu Abdullah we look at, there are lessons to be derived. So this is why when we say crying for the masiba of Sayyid al-Shuhada reduces and takes away great sins, is because of this revolution, is because of this reformation, because of this ethical change which creates within human beings. Not just come and cry and go. No, come and cry and change. Come and cry and reform yourself and reform others. The same way that Sayyid al-Shuhada says, "Inni lam akhruj ashran wala batra wala zaliman wala mufsida. Innama kharajtu li talab al-islah fi ummati jaddi Rasulullah." I'm not going there to fight anyone. I'm not after power. I'm not after position. I'm not after bloodshed. No. What is the reason I'm going? What is the reason? I'm going to reform the sunnah, the seerah, the manhaj, the path of my grandfather Rasulullah. I want to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. So this is the Hussein that we weep over and we cry over and we remember every year, every month, and every day. That in Ziyarah Nahiyah, the Imam of our time says that, "Oh my grandfather, even if the tears of my eyes are to be dried, I will shed blood for you, O Hussein." That is why people like Sayyid Ali Qazi, people like Allama Tawatabai, people like Ayatollah Jawadi, they say, recite this Ziyarat Ashura every day. Not every day of Ashura, every day recite Ziyarat Ashura. Because every day the call of Hussein is there, and every day the call of Yazid is there. And we find that roughly 20 days after Ashura, what is heartbreaking, of course, you have heard the stories of Sayyid al-Shuhada, that after the day of Ashura, the enemy take the bodies, take the heads towards Kufa. Upon horses, upon camels without saddle, they parade them in the streets of Kufa. The same Kufa that Amir al-Mu'mineen used to go look after the women, the widows, the children. Now his own children, his own grandchildren are being paraded in the middle of the streets of Kufa. One woman, the Maqtal says, that comes forward and he says that, who are these individuals? They respond and he says that, we are the children of Rasulullah. This is what they are doing to us. And then the people of Kufa, they would cry and they would cry. You know what Imam Sajjad says? Imam Zainul Abidin says, أَتَنْهُونَ وَتَبْكُونَ مِنْ أَجْنِنَا. You're crying, you're weeping for our sake. فَمَنَ الَّذِي قَتَلَنَا. So who is the individuals who killed us? You, the people of Kufa, were the ones who wrote 18,000 letters and you pledged allegiance to Muslim for us to come. Who killed us then? And Zainab salamullah alayha gave that beautiful khutbah. He says, you are individuals who fooled us, you are the individuals who deceived us, until it came to this few lines I recite and I'll end. Imam Sajjad, Imam Zainul Abidin, also recites a beautiful khutbah. Simple, however it breaks the heart. Imam Zainul Abidin says, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ مَنْ عَرَفَنِي فَقَدْ عَرَفَنِي. All people, whoever knows me, then they know me. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفْنِي فَأَنَا أُعَرِّفُ لِنَفْسِي. And whoever does not know me, you do not know who you are doing this to, I will introduce myself. Let me say who I am. أَنَا عَلِيُّ بْنِ الْحُسَيْنِ بْنِ أَبِي طَالِبِ. I am the son of Hussein, the son of Amir al-Mu'mineen. أَنَا ابْنُ الْمَذْبُوهِ بِشَتِّ الْفُرَادِ. I am the son of the one who is slaughtered next to the Euphrates. أَنَا ابْنُ مَنْ انْتُهِكَ حَرِيمُهُ وَسُلِبَ نَئِيمُهُ. I am the son of that individual that their tents were violated, their rights were taken away. I am the son of that man who next to the Euphrates they would allow the animals, their own horses, to go and drink water. However, my father, my uncle, my auntie, and his household were left without drink, without food. وَانْتُهِبَ مَالَهُ وَسُبِيَ عَيَالَهُ. I am the son of the one that his family members were held as captive. You are the ones who sent those letters. May Allah remove His mercy upon you. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. مَاتَمَ حُسَيْنْ. يَا حُسَيْنْ. يَا حُسَيْنْ. يَا حُسَيْنْ. يَا حُسَيْنْ.